Hi, I'm Tamara, and this is TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Hi, everyone. Today we are speaking with Dr. Wendy Craig, who is a professor and head of the Department of Psychology at Queen's University. And we are speaking with Matthew Johnson, and Matthew is the Director of Education for MediaSmarts, which is Canada's Centre for Digital and Media Literacy. So welcome, both of you. Thank you so much for being here. We have lots to dig into. Wendy, why don't we start with you and talk about a little bit about your background and your research and what it focuses on.
So I've been studying bullying for the last 30 years. And what I'm really interested in is the development of the use of power and aggression as kids grow. And so that involves looking at bullying, cyberbullying, teen dating violence. And we do different forms of research. We do research with surveys with children. We do research putting kids in MRI machines and looking at what's happening on the brain. And we also do observational research. We watch them and we record their interactions. And that really helps us understand the dynamics that underlie behaviors like bullying and cyberbullying.
Okay. That's I have a lot of questions for you. Matthew, you're an expert in digital literacy. What does that mean? What does MediaSmarts do?
So MediaSmarts is Canada's Centre for Digital and Media Literacy. And since the 1990s, we've been working to advocate for media literacy and to provide resources for parents and teachers and young people to help make sure that all Canadian children and youth have the critical thinking skills and increasingly the ethical decision-making skills that they need to understand and actively engage with all of the media that they consume. And of course, increasingly, that is digital media. Of course, all of the issues that we always had with traditional media are still with us. Things like gender representation, things like body image issues, things diversity representation, advertising, violence, and so on. But of course, because digital media, unlike traditional media, is networked and interactive, we also have ethical concerns, we have privacy concerns, but we also have the ability to make an impact, to answer back, and to be an active and engaged citizen and consumer in a way that was much more difficult under the old media model.
I think that when we think about our kids being online and how much they're online, especially with the pandemic and, for the last 6 months, we've been at home so much. I know I'm mostly concerned about how much time my kids are spending online. Should I be worried about, is it the time that matters, Matthew, or there's so much to worry about, it feels like, but what about time? How much time?
So this is something that we looked at when we were part of the Canadian Pediatric Society's Digital Health Task Force, and we were involved in actually developing the screen time recommendations for small children and school-aged youth. And really, when we updated those recommendations, it was a question of turning away from counting hours and minutes to more of an idea of paying more attention to what young people are doing with their screen devices. Now, of course, time can still be an issue, but rather than looking at it just in terms of how much time they're spending, we look at what is it taking away. So is it taking away sleep? Is it taking away time spent with friends and family? Is it taking away time spent outside or exercising or doing other activities that they enjoy? If it's not doing those things, then you want to focus on what they're doing with it. Are they using it for things that are educational, where they're genuinely learning something? Are they using it for creative purposes, where they are building something or making something? Are they doing something that involves getting exercise or going outside, like geocaching or Pokemon Go? Or are they doing something that's genuinely social? So, for instance, playing video games with someone else on the couch next to them, or possibly in these days with a mask on to at least 2 meters away, but actually having someone else there in the room who's playing with you rather than playing by yourself or even playing with someone that maybe you don't know.
So Wendy,
it's a really interesting question because The research has now really moved away from time spent online as and thinking about what Matthew was saying, what you're doing. But it's also, there's another thing that they're looking at, and it's preference for being online versus having face-to-face contact. So that's another risk factor. When kids prefer to be online rather than, compulsively, rather than going and spending time with their friends, then that's a problem. And they've now introduced a new concept called problematic social media use, which is really takes an addictions framework. It means I can't do it without it. I need it. I prefer to be with it versus people seeing people face to face. And that's when it's a concern versus, yeah, as you were saying, not like how much time, only if it's replacing those social interactions, which help make us healthy.
I feel sometimes that there's this idea that if your kid isn't online and isn't doing these things, then they're missing out on, it's this idea, this sort of herd mentality that, well, all the kids are on social media right now. That's how they communicate, Tamara. And that's how they get invited out to go to things. And if you don't let your kids do this, then they're going to be left out.
I think since COVID, the world has changed, right? And I think one of the really positive things is that we've stopped demonizing being online. Being online is actually become a critical part and a critical way that we connect with one another. So I think COVID has sort of helped adults see that there are benefits to being online. There are also dangers and risks that we might be worried about. But the benefits are, especially in times of COVID, we can use it to connect with others. We can use it to have relationships. We can use it to play with games with others and have that kind of entertainment and enjoyment and fun with our friends and our family. So I think that there's been a real shift that moves from demonizing to recognizing the value and the positives associated with being online. And part of that for kids is being online and knowing what's happening. Fear of missing out on things is real. And sometimes being online enables kids to have that social knowledge.
Matthew, do you find that, I'm of a generation that, I didn't grow up with a phone in my hand. The first phone I ever had was so heavy, it had a shoulder strap. And now my kids, they all want, they're small, they're, 10, 12, and 13. And they seem to think that they should have an iPhone 11 Pro Max or whatever it is, and it's like, no, that doesn't, where is this line where we have parents who are learning this as we go and kids who know more than we do when it comes to online stuff?
Yeah, well, in some ways, that's a good example of how media literacy and digital literacy are still so intertwined, because to a certain extent, what we're really looking at is just old-fashioned consumerism. That phones are today what having the right kind of genes were 20 years ago. I suspect you still also have to have the right kind of genes. It's just another thing that you have to have, right? So, and that's why traditional media literacy, of course, is still relevant, because we have to look at, well, what is telling you that? How do you get the message that you need to have the best kind of phone or that you need to upgrade your phone every year? And what are some of the tricks that they do, whether they're advertising tricks or sometimes technical tricks, to encourage you to upgrade or to discourage you from not upgrading? But when we look at the actual use of the devices, I think a lot of it is wanting to do what their friends are doing. And so you will see different patterns where if your child's friends are all playing a particular game, of course, they'll want to play that and they'll want to have whatever device that lets them do that. If they're all on a particular social network, then they're going to want to be on that same social network with their friends. And so when we come to mobile devices, that becomes a tricky issue because, of course, it's so hard to monitor what our kids are doing on mobile devices. And we don't recommend generally using intrusive kinds of monitoring like surveillance software because we feel it sends the wrong message, unless there's a good reason why your kids have shown that they need to be directly supervised. We think it's generally a bad idea. And so what that means is that what we usually say is that before your kids are using a mobile device, you have to be pretty confident that they've internalized the rules and the values that you want them to live by. And so a new phone, or the desire for a new phone, especially if it's the first one they get, can be a really good opportunity if you haven't formalized household rules around internet use and screen device use. This is a really great opportunity to do it. And our research does show consistently that household rules do make a difference in how kids behave, even with teenagers. It may not seem like it, but it actually does. And the reason they do that is almost certainly not because kids are worried about the consequences, because kids generally aren't, especially teens. They're not worried about consequences of their actions. But it's because rules communicate values. It's because it's making explicit to them the values you want them to live by when they're online, that you want them to treat people with respect, and you want them to respect their privacy and other people's privacy. You want them, you know, to answer your texts so you don't go nuts if it's 11:30 and you don't know where they are. But this is an opportunity to do that if you haven't done so already. And if you already have done so, then it's an opportunity to take another look at those, and maybe get your child involved in developing appropriate rules for their age.
Mm-hmm. Wendy, when we, you know, as an adult, I'm probably on my phone too much, you know, so how are parents, you know, we're talking about household rules around, you know, devices and online time. If I'm not, like, can you give me an example, Wendy, of some household rules when, if I'm a parent though, that spends a lot of time on my phone, I try to explain to my kids that this is a computer and I can answer an email on here. That's why I'm looking at it. You know, if they're critiquing me about being on my phone all the time, how can I give my kids household rules?
I think one of the things I always say is that working with your child around the use of their technology is just good parenting practices. So what do we do when we're a good parent? We role model, you know, so what are appropriate kinds of behaviors to do online in terms of how I use it, what I use it for, and how I, you know, the quality and the content of how I interact. So I think helping children understand, like, your rules should be, yes, about that we're not going to have it during dinner. That dinner is a time when we're going to have face-to-face communication and talk to one another. That we're in the middle of a conversation, we don't go on our phones. Or if we go on our phones because we're looking up something to facilitate that conversation, then we let them know that that's what it's about. So I think when we think about helping and supporting children developing good practices in terms of the use of their devices, we're role models. And we also are educators, that we have to work with them and teach them and explicitly educate them about how to use it, what is the etiquette in terms of using it, and when to use it. And it's a really positive opportunity for us to interact with our kids, to also learn from them about what to use it for and what they're using it for, and helping them then use those media literacy skills that Matthew was talking about. So I think it's really critical for us to realize that that helping our child to develop positive use of their technology is us about being good parents, and we all can do that.
So as an adult, I know what to do if I feel like I'm being bullied online, or if I feel like, you know, there's a troll that's commenting on something. It's very difficult to explain this to children. How do we identify cyberbullying? How do we know as parents if our child is being cyberbullied? Wendy?
Well, I think the first thing to know is that we have to be able to recognize the signs. So we have to educate ourselves. So what are the signs of children being cyberbullied online? They may be more withdrawn. They may just be acting a little more differently than they usually do. So they might be more anxious. They might be more private. They actually might close the devices down when you come around because they don't want you to see what's happening in their lives. But they're not likely to communicate it with us. And part of that's because kids don't actually believe that adults are effective in dealing with cyberbullying. So as an adult, we have to be aware of what it is, what it looks like, and what the impact might look like on our children. And then be courageous. Have those courageous conversations. Initiate a conversation with them about asking them about what's going on in their life, asking them about the quality of their interactions. So that you want to, as a parent, create a relationship where they'll feel free to report to you. The next thing I always like to tell parents is it's about how you receive that information from them. That I, as a parent, when something goes wrong in my child's life, I want to run in. I want to be the mother lioness. But I have to hold that back. What they need in that moment is for us to hear about their experiences. We need to listen and not run in and solve it. And then we need to work with them in a collaborative way to identify solutions. And it's really important because solutions that we come up with as adults aren't really highly valued by the child themselves necessarily, or they're not going to be implemented. So we have to agree on those solutions and support them in enacting those solutions and let them take the lead. Because the last thing that we want to do is when we're helping them deal with cyberbullying is bully them into a solution. So we want a role model, being kind and being compassionate, being a good listener and working collaboratively on problem solving to move forward. So I think those are some really critical parenting skills that we bring when they have any kind of problem. And again, that's why I say there's no app for cyberbullying. It's all about good parenting.
Interesting. Okay, Matthew. So when we think about cyberbullying, and I feel like everybody has very different ideas of what bullying looks like online. Is bullying anything that hurts your feelings?
Well, not necessarily. There are technical definitions of bullying, but in a lot of cases, the things that hurt kids don't necessarily fit that definition. So part of the classic definition of bullying is that there has to be a power differential between the perpetrator and the target, but that's not always clear online. So one of the parts of the definition is that it has to be repeated, but sometimes a single action can be very hurtful, or sometimes because of the nature of digital media, if it's something like an embarrassing photo or video being shared, the original perpetrator may only do it once, but it can still happen hundreds or thousands or millions of times as other people see it. So cyberbullying doesn't look just like one thing, and what really matters is the impact that it has on the child. Really, anything that is hurting, anything that is preventing your child from taking part in the communities or the activities that they enjoy, and really anything that is hurting their relationships, because we know that cyberbullying, just like regular bullying, is primarily something that happens between kids who know one another offline. It's not always the case. There are some cases like video game griefing where it is people you don't know offline, but primarily these are relationships that already exist. And so if it's harming the relationship, and we do know in a lot of cases that what kids will sometimes call drama, because they don't want to call it bullying. Sometimes it is and sometimes it isn't. But this can happen very easily because of the nature of online communication. That most of the time, when we're communicating online, we're missing a lot of the cues that tell us how other people are feeling. And so it's very easy to cross a line without realizing it. So if you've ever spent any time among teenagers, especially teenage boys, but girls to a certain extent as well, there's a lot of teasing, there's a lot of jockeying, there's a lot of testing those limits. The same things happen online, but when that happens in person, you can see when you've gone too far and you can take a step back. You can say, oh, I was just kidding, man, or just joking, or I didn't really mean that. But online, you don't get those cues. You don't see the look on their face. You don't see the body language. You don't hear the tone of voice when they say, yeah, do you really mean that? And so they get hurt and maybe they snap back at you. And as a result, you think that they've overreacted because so far as you're concerned, you just said something innocuous and they snapped at you. So you don't know why they're hurt. They don't know why you're hurt. And that's a recipe for drama.
Yeah, it is. And Wendy, when I think about, you know, raising girls online and what they see online, and what I've noticed is there is this real, I mean, again, it's no different than when I grew up and I would read a magazine. But now girls are looking at TikTok and seeing, you know, these sexy dances or whatever it is, and they're trying to do them, but they're nine. And, you know, it's, this is something that so many parents don't know how to, you know, do this. I'll be honest with you, Wendy, like a lot of us, you know, helped our kids sign up on TikTok for an app that they're not even old enough to do. So I know it falls back on good parenting, is right?
Yeah, I think it's really, it's going to come back. There's going to be a theme in this discussion, right?
I know.
It's going to come back to digital literacy skills, right? If we let our kids go on those kinds of sites, and we can make that choice as adults, then we have to help them understand what they're seeing and contextualize that and help them understand and be aware of the potential impacts of that. So, you know, for girls, they want to go on social media. One of their key motivations is to connect and to have information, because information online brings social power. And, you know, the other thing that we have to do is think about what are they seeing and what are those images that they're seeing and how does that reflect how they view themselves and their perceptions about what it means to be a girl and what it means to have healthy relationships and what it means to engage in relationships. So I think it comes down to, again, like we have to provide them with the digital literacy skills. We have to help them build the relationship skills about it face-to-face and online. How do you interact with others online in a way that's safe and still can build that intimacy and trust and friendship that you want? But it's also about helping them understand the impact of being online and seeing these things and what that means and just connecting with them and talking about it. You know, like one of the things I like to do is ask my child, what's your favorite TikTok? Show it to me. Why do you like this? What does that mean to you? Like, what's attractive to this and what's not? Because that starts the conversation, and it starts the conversation about maybe unpacking that, what they're watching and its impact.
And Matthew, what I've noticed is with online learning, right? So now our kids are online more than ever and they're learning online. And there are these side chats happening. So they're being taught, there's not supposed to be any chatting happening, but there is chatting happening. And I mean, and everybody seems to send two or three words and then hits send and then two or three words more. So like a text message can be extremely long. There are signs of bullying, or as you were saying, Matthew, we can't read your social cues in person, right? So, and so how do we as parents, again, does this come back to a conversation about it, or do we check our kids' chats?
I don't think most of the time you need to check your kids' chats. I think anytime you're sort of invading privacy like that, you should have a reason for doing it, and you should talk to your kids about it first. But what that does show us is that, you know, there's a limit to what monitoring can do. You know, teachers can't necessarily monitor every chat channel. And of course, because kids can switch between tabs and windows, they could be chatting on a completely different channel, completely different app or platform that their teacher has no access to at all while all this is happening. So that's why when we talk to kids about cyberbullying or any kind of ethical online behavior, we don't just talk about what to do if you're targeted by it. You have to talk about first what it is and help them understand that it really hurts. And we know from research that we've done with things like cyberbullying and things like online prejudice that there is an empathy gap that a lot of times people don't realize how much it hurts. And when we talked to young people about prejudice online, a lot of them said that they, one of the things that would make them more likely to do something about it, to report it or stand up to it, was if they knew that it had hurt someone. But at the same time, the same students or the same young people told us consistently that it hurt. So they knew it hurt. They knew it hurt them, but they needed to be told that it was hurting other people to be able to act. So helping them get over that empathy gap, helping them to realize the things that hurt us offline, hurt us online as well, and that we have to be a little more thoughtful. We do have to think about how what your words might mean. And we also have to prepare them as witnesses, because in almost every case, when bullying happens, there is a witness. It may be an after-the-fact witness. You're being a witness when your kids come to you and say something happened, or when you discover something happens. But fairly often, there is a witness when it happens. A lot of times, bullying happens in front of an audience. Sometimes it's an audience after the fact. Mm. But there are things that kids tell us can help, and this is research that we've done with Wendy and with PrevNet, that really do make a difference. And it's important for kids to know that there are things they can do that make a difference, that aren't going to get them in trouble, that aren't going to put them in danger, and aren't going to make things worse, because that's what young people tell us is one of the main reasons they don't intervene and when they witness it. Sometimes it's because they're worried about becoming targets themselves. Sometimes it's because they're worried about making things worse. And there certainly are cases where that can happen. And in fact, the top ranked strategy that they told us about was simply comforting the target. So just going, contacting the target in private and letting them know, I think what happened isn't wrong. Is there something I can do to help? And asking them. But we have to equip them. We have to give them, we have to empower them to be engaged witnesses, but we also have to provide them with a toolbox so they know there are different things they can do in different situations. There isn't just one thing that works.
Right. So there's a lot of misinformation out there. And sometimes adults can't even tell what is true information and what isn't. It's very hard to navigate this with kids because they seem to think that a lot of them seem to think that what is online is true. It's just like, you know, what they see is true. And I had a good learning moment over here when my daughter tried to cook dry pasta in the microwave, like she saw on TikTok. And it started a fire in the microwave. So of course it did. And I had to explain to her that just because it's on TikTok doesn't mean that it's real. There's also news that's coming in through social media that, you know, people just post whatever, and kids are seeing, you know, and teens are seeing information that maybe isn't real. There's also racism. There is something that comes to mind is the new teacher challenge. Did you guys see that on the new teacher challenge? So it was this thing where adults took a picture of somebody with a disability that, you know, somebody who's mentally ill and maybe did some time in jail in their mugshot, or just, you know, pictures that weren't your happy, you know, and then they said, oh, here's your new teacher, and recorded their child seeing this. And it was very hurtful for a lot of people. But a lot of people thought it was funny. So when we get into this, you know, there's these campaigns that have started, right? The break the fake and check then share. So can Wendy, why don't we start with you? And can you maybe speak a little bit about, you know, all this misinformation that kids are bombarded with?
Yeah, I you know, this is really something that Matthew can really talk about from the perspective of MediaSmarts, but I want to make two comments that are related to this and follow up on what Matthew said. What are the two things that we need to develop and teach in our kids? You know, one is empathy, and it's related to what's the impact of these actions. So when we engage in these behaviors, what's the impact? And then the second thing is that we call moral disengagement. Like, we want kids to be morally engaged. If kids believe that the behavior is not right or it's wrong, they're more likely to intervene. They're more likely to stand up and do something about it. And that's what we want to develop in kids. So when they see these horrific kinds of racism or these other images where that are hurtful, we want, and we actually see for kids who defend other kids in terms of cyberbullying, we actually, when we look at what happens in the brain in that moment, we see the areas of the brain that are associated with empathy light up. So these kids have deep empathy. And when we have empathy, it activates us to do something about it. That's the next area of the brain that gets lit up when we see these images. So empathy is really critical to develop in our kids.
Can you teach empathy?
We can teach empathy. We can be role models in how to be empathetic. We can provide scripts for our kids about, wow, that sounds like that really hurt. That was really hurtful. Or, wow, I bet you that didn't feel very nice for that person who experienced it. Or we can ask our kids, you know, when you see that image, what do you think the experience is of the person that it's happening to? You know, if that was you, what would you experience? So we can help kids put themselves in other people's shoes, and that's helping them develop empathy.
Matthew, what do you think about all of these, you know, how do we put language around, you know, these different memes that kids are seeing or fake information, racism? How do we help them identify this?
Well, a lot of it does go back to basic media and digital literacy. So, you know, on a fundamental media literacy, we need to teach kids early the idea that media are constructions, that what we see in any kind of medium, even if it's one that claims to be representing reality or that aims to represent reality, like news or documentary or social media, all of these things are constructed. They're made, they're selected. Sometimes the images were selected by the creators, as they may are. We all know that, you know, we don't put every photo of ourselves up on Instagram. You know, you choose the best one, and lots of people will take 30 and pick one, or then maybe you filter it after that. So maybe it's been curated and it's also been altered. But even things that are aiming to be accurate reflections of reality, they can't be. Even if they are following best practices, you know, the fact is there's only so much room in a newspaper, right? Mm. And even the order that things are in, whether it's in a print newspaper, what's on the first page, what's on page 20, on a news website, what's on the homepage, what do you have to follow three links to get to? These are decisions that people made, and they may not reflect our sense of what's important, of the priorities. Maybe we think that coverage of, you know, an anti-poverty march is more important than coverage of a murder. And we would put that on page one, but the newspaper feels differently. And neither one of those is necessarily right, but it shows that someone is making a choice that doesn't necessarily objectively reflect reality, because you can't objectively reflect reality. Even if you look, when you look in a mirror, only the things that are in the mirror are being reflected. Mm. So we teach that early on, and as they get older and they start using digital media for information gathering, which usually happens with school, but it can be interest-based as well. Sometimes it can be things like food hacks on TikTok. Sometimes, I know with my kids, a lot of it was related to video games. You have to teach them that expertise and authority matters, that there are people who maybe are not going to be honest or are simply wrong. And in the final analysis, it doesn't really matter whether someone is being dishonest or someone is simply wrong. You have to identify why someone might be thought of as an expert. You want to identify the reasons behind why they're sharing this information. Is it to genuinely to inform you? Is it a prank? Is it to try to sell something? Is it part of a bullying effort against a person or a group? Because we know that a lot of the misinformation that's going around right now, it's not just aimed at pranks. You know, it's not just people sharing stories from The Onion because they don't know The Onion is a joke. It's not just even stuff that's being made to make money, to sell supplements, although selling supplements is usually at the bottom of it somewhere. A lot of it is as part of an attack on particular groups in society. And so all of these things do come together, that early understanding, and of course it's always part of a continuing conversation, but the understanding that has to start early, that media are constructions that were made by somebody that we have to question the decisions that went into them. We have to be aware that these are the product of decisions people made, or increasingly decisions algorithms made.
Yeah.
And then we have to teach them easy steps for identifying whether something is reliable. And those are the four steps that we cover in our Break the Fake campaign, which are using fact-checking tools like Snopes, finding the original source, because it doesn't matter whether, you know, if your Uncle Bob shares something with you, it doesn't matter if you trust your Uncle Bob. What matters is whether you can trust the person who originated the story. Verifying a source. So once you've tracked it to the original source, finding out, is this someone with a good track record? And if they're purporting to be an authority, are they really? Do they have good reason to claim that? Mm-hmm. And finally, consulting other sources, putting the network nature of the internet to good use, so that you can get context and consensus to find out, for instance, what do most people say about cooking spaghetti? Can you put it in the microwave, or is water generally a good idea? You know,
right.
A quick search for just, you know, honestly, cook spaghetti will show you, yeah, it might be a good way to reheat it, not a great way to cook dry spaghetti.
Yes, exactly. And Wendy, you know, when we think about predators online, we've talked a lot about bullying here, but again, the internet is, I mean, when I give my kid an iPad to look at, I've basically set them up with the entire world at their fingertips, unless I start putting some filters on and stuff like that. So I'm wondering, Wendy, when, you know, at what point in a child's development can we start letting them know that there are bad people out there that might try to trick them? Like, my kids like to play Roblox and stuff. So, you know, I always say, well, how do you know that that's really a kid? How do you know it's not a 50-year-old man? Like, he's trying to, and they're like, Mom, I know if it is or not. And I'm like, well, no, you don't know. And I try to have this conversation, but is there, can I scare them too much? Like, where is this line where we can start letting them know about this?
Well, I think the first thing is we want to start early. And part of it is developing those digital literacy skills. But also part of it is, you know, we don't just give a child a two-wheeler bike and say, go, you know, ride the bike. They can't. What do? We start with training wheels. And then, you know, and then we are holding on the back seat. And when they get the hang of it, we let go of the back seat. And then when they get the hang of that, we take off the training wheels. Right. And that's the same thing with exposing them to things on the internet. And it's the same thing with giving them this autonomous access. We don't just let them go into the world without prepping them, without preparing them, without doing it in slow steps that we're comfortable with. That's also part of it. What is we are parents? What are our limits? What are our boundaries? What do we feel comfortable with that reflect our values about how much time, where we're going to let them go? So we're going to go online with them in the beginning, and we're going to do some things with them together in a way, and then help unpack some of these dilemmas or some of these challenges that they might face, like whether it be going for a product, whether it be trying something that they see in the TikTok, or whether it be talking to somebody who responds to them while they're playing a game. We're going to then say, you know, how do you know that this person is safe, and build those skills with them. So I always think about it as we're helping our kids develop autonomy online. We're helping them become independent online. We're just not starting at independence. We're building that. So we're moving from doing things together, building the skills, and slowly letting go and trusting that they develop those skills, and checking in with them once in a while to make sure that they're safe online. So it's a process, and we have to start early and graduate it. And we're really scaffolding safety and healthy digital literacy skills online.
Where does it go from here, Matthew? Like, when, I mean, I feel sometimes like, oh, we have TikTok and Instagram and Facebook and Twitter and all these things happening. And assuming there will be more and more and more as we grow into this, and we'll get away from, you know, our physical, and we're in a space now where we're not supposed to see each other, right? We're without a mask. And so how do we set, can you maybe give me an example of, you know, a couple of rules you have in your house when it comes to online?
Sure. And, you know, one of the great advantages of taking an approach that's based on key concepts, and our media and digital literacy program is based on five key concepts of media literacy that go back to the 1980s. And the first of those is that media are constructions, and five key concepts of digital literacy that we developed just a few years ago that start with the idea that digital media are networked. And the other key concepts are implications of those two. And the advantage of starting with those is that they adapt. There's a reason we're still using the key concepts of media literacy that were developed in the 1980s and that really at heart go back to the 1960s and 70s, because even though the content has changed, the issues that come with media have not changed. And fairly often updating resources is just a matter of, you know, instead of talking about something that was representing diversity or gender 10 years ago, we're talking about something that's representing it now, but in many cases, the issues are the same. So it's very much the same. And digital media, it was the interactive network nature of it. That's the only change that we've made in 25 years, almost as an organization, to the key concepts. So using those as the base helps you develop rules, and it helps you develop conversations that are relevant no matter what the platform, because the great thing is that your kids are always going to be more familiar with the platform than you are. So you can use that as an opportunity to ask them the key concepts, give you the way to come up with the right questions, and they give you the answers. So in terms of rules, our number one rule, and that's true, the number one rule we recommend and our number one rule here is, if anything happens to you when you're online that upsets you, come to me right away and tell me about it, and I promise I will not freak out. And that's something that we need to start saying to kids as soon as they start using digital devices. And there's really good research, particularly some out of the UK, that shows that's actually the most effective approach. It's more effective than filtering. It's more effective than walled gardens. It is, they have to know that they can come to you. And Wendy mentioned this earlier, but I really want to underline it. They have to know that they can come to you. They have to know that you are not going to take the devices away or overreact. And they also need to be part of an ongoing conversation. That you're absolutely right, Tamara, that technology and screens are such a big part of our kids' lives and our lives, and that's why it needs to be part of the conversation. You know, at the end of a school day, when you're all together having your device-free dinner, you ask, how was school? And we have to have those same conversations about whatever they're doing with technology. We have to say, what's the new game like? What do you like about it? And you have to ask questions like, well, can you communicate with people? Is there a chat function? Can you turn it off? What do other people know about you? What do you have to say when you're signing up for this? And questions that are different maybe for games and social networks, but understanding the concepts behind digital literacy give you those questions and the ability to come up with questions. And that becomes a co-learning experience between you and your kids. And that's really valuable for both of you.
It's really valuable what you just said. I love that number one rule, and it makes sense. It really does make sense. And Wendy,
the other really important thing about what he said, and I really want to highlight it as a message for parents, is restricting children's access is not a strategy that's going to be successful. In all of the things that he just talked about, it was about collaboration. It was about co-creating the rules. It was about unpacking things with kids. So you're a team, and you need to work together in a collaborative way in either understanding what they're seeing and making those rules, or creating opportunity to have discussion about what's going on. But being restrictive does not, what are they learning? I always think about, what are they learning when we take away kids' devices? They're learning that if I tell my parents, then I'm going to lose access. And that's the absolute wrong message we want to send, right? We want them to learn to come to us, rule number one. So I think I just really want to highlight that, because it's such an important
It is a good point. I mean, for those of us that didn't grow up with, you know, iPads and phones and all that sort of stuff, we can easily think back to things that our parents took away from us and how that made us feel and how we rebelled in our own old-fashioned ways. And as we're wrapping up, Wendy, what do you think is the most important thing to keep in mind when we're raising responsible cyber citizens?
Wow, that's a really great question. And I think it's just coming back to being the good parenting, you know, that it's just taking our parenting skills and applying them to the cyber world or the social media world and trusting ourselves in being able to do that. We don't have to understand how every app or every software works, but we do have to understand how do we support our kids? How do we recognize when our kids are in trouble? And how do we create that parent-child relationship that will enable them to come and talk to us? And so that's what I would say is the most important.
Yeah,
trust
it sounds
your
like
parenting instincts.
And it's about communication, right? Conversations with we talk to our kids about all kinds of things, and this is just one more thing that we that we talk about and discuss. You guys have been fantastic. There's so much information. I know I can get more information on your website. So Matthew, your website is MediaSmarts.ca.
That's right.
People can go there. They can find out. And that's also your handle for Twitter, Instagram, everything else, right? At
yes.
MediaSmarts. Perfect.
Yes.
And Dr. Craig, your website is Prevnet.ca. That's Prevnet.ca. And on Twitter, you are Prof. Wendy Craig. Are you on Instagram?
Not yet. Nope.
Good for you. Thank you so much, both of you. It has been a real pleasure, and we've learned a lot today. So thank you for sharing your time with us.
Thank you.
Thank you for having me.
Thanks for listening to another episode of TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Be sure to subscribe so you can join us every Tuesday for another conversation. You can also check out our website, telus.com/podcast, and subscribe to our YouTube channel at TELUS Talks.